Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture today on secondary amenorrhea. In our last class, we have learned about the pituitary causes of secondary amenorrhea. Now let us learn the other causes of secondary amenorrhea and also the diagnosis and treatment of secondary amenorrhea. Next, the other causes include uterine causes of secondary amenorrhea. So let us learn the uterine causes of secondary amenorrhea. The uterine causes of secondary amenorrhea include, see, this is the uterus, fallopian tube. This is the ovary. Okay. These are the fimbriae. And this is the uterus, cervix. Okay. And then vagina. Now, what are the uterine causes of secondary amenorrhea? Whenever there is Asherman syndrome, then that can cause secondary amenorrhea. What is Asherman syndrome? Asherman syndrome is the formation of intrauterine synechiae. In the uterus, there are formation of adhesions or synechiae. What are the main causes of this Asherman syndrome? The main cause is vigorous curettage. Whenever we do vigorous curettage postpartum or after abortion, vigorous curettage can cause some raw ends on either sides of the uterus. That raw ends, when they come together, they lead to the formation of adhesions. Okay. Mostly when the functional basal layer of the endometrium is scraped off, then there is an increased chance of formation of these adhesions. And the second cause is genital tuberculosis. In genital tuberculosis, there is formation of adhesions in the uterus because there is formation of caseous necrosis. That caseous necrosis may transform itself and it may form adhesions. So in that case also, there is secondary amenorrhea. The third one is cervical stenosis. In some operations, this cervical stenosis most commonly occurs after the operation of cone biopsy. Here, any operation of the cervix, like cone biopsy or cervical amputation, in such cases, there is formation of cervical stenosis. So even if there is cervical stenosis, in all these cases, though the ovum is released, the endometrial changes may not be possible. Though the endometrial changes are possible and ovum is released, it cannot come out. So that is the main cause of uterine causes. These are the main uterine causes of secondary amenorrhea. The other causes of secondary amenorrhea are other endocrinopathies. In this, one of it is late onset congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Here there is adrenal hyperplasia. Because of that, there is increased sex hormones and late onset adrenal hyperplasia, whenever it occurs after a certain age, not in the childhood but after a certain age, then that causes secondary amenorrhea. And hypothyroidism can also call secondary amenorrhea. First it causes menorrhagia and then this may progress to secondary amenorrhea. And Cushing's disease. In Cushing's disease, there is overproduction of ACTH by the pituitary. Cushing's disease can be one ACTH dependent and other ACTH independent. In ACTH dependent, whenever there is increased production of ACTH by the pituitary, that will activate the adrenal glands and that adrenal gland will produce increased adrenal hormones, including the sex hormones. Whereas in non-ACTH dependent Cushing syndrome, in that there's some problem in the adrenal tumor or something that will produce increased adrenocortical hormones. So, and also whenever there is increased cortisol, that also causes secondary amenorrhea. Even that should be noted, that whenever there is increased cortisol, that is even in Cushing syndrome, where there is increased cortisol, that will also cause secondary amenorrhea. So these are the different causes of secondary amenorrhea. Now how are we going to evaluate the secondary amenorrhea? Evaluation. We'll have to take history. In the history, we'll have to take menstrual history in clearly whether there is hypomenorrhea, decreased menstrual cycles, and then first irregular menstrual cycles, and then did it start with irregular menstrual cycle and then progress to amenorrhea, or it has started suddenly with amenorrhea. That should be taken into account. And you should also take about the history of loss of weight or weight gain. Then you should take the history of tuberculosis. or galactorrhea, whenever is there any galactorrhea for hyperprolactinemia. Or you'll have to take the symptoms of menopause, whether there are any hot flashes or vaginal dryness or sleep disturbances, or whether there is any mood disturbances, mood changes, hot flashes, because all these will point out towards the early menopausal symptoms, which can be premature ovarian failure or any other pathology. And then any endocrinopathy, symptoms of thyroid disease should be taken into account, symptoms of adrenal disease like symptoms of Cushing syndrome, all these should be just asked, and then we'll have to get history from the patient. And once we have taken the history, we'll have to go to the physical examination. So in the physical examination, we should see the height, weight, body mass index of the individual, and also blood pressure should be taken, and then signs of hyperandrogenism, because whenever there is increased androgenism, there is acne, hirsutism, virilization, all these, acanthosis nigricans for PCOS, polycystic ovarian disease. For that, we'll have to take these, and breast examination should be done, and we should rule out galactorrhea, because for hyperprolactinemia, there is a chance of galactorrhea. So all these should be taken into account. And then the main evaluation for the main test which we do for secondary amenorrhea is progesterone challenge test. So in that, we do first progesterone challenge test, and then we do estrogen and progesterone challenge test. What do we do first is, whenever a woman comes with secondary amenorrhea with absence of periods for either 3 cycles if it's irregular and 6 cycles if it's regular, in such cases you will do first a pregnancy test to rule out pregnancy. Okay, if this pregnancy test is negative, then we will do a test which is called as progesterone challenge test. In this progesterone challenge test, we give progesterone. But before we go to the progesterone challenge test, you should know that this is the uterus. Okay, here the estrogen, normally if you see, okay, estrogen which is there, that will prime the endometrium. Okay. Estrogen will prime the endometrium normally. So there is endometrium. In the endometrium, there are some estrogen remnants. Okay. Now, whenever we give, so this has estrogen primes the endometrium. This will prove that if estrogen can prime the endometrium, then this will prove that there is normal estrogen production. In our body, production of estrogen is normal. That will show that the production of the estrogen is normal. If we prove that there is estrogen which is priming the endometrium, then that shows that estrogen is normal in our body. So in progesterone challenge test, what we do is we give progesterone. Okay, if progesterone is given, if for example, what progesterone is given, it can be medroxyprogesterone acetate. We can give either medroxyprogesterone acetate 10 milligrams is given for 7 to 10 days, or we can give norethisterone, which is 5 milligrams. It is given for 7 to 10 days, or you can give micronized progesterone. This is given for 400, this is given in the dose of 400 milligrams orally for 7 to 10 days. Okay, we give these progesterones, any one of them. So we give any one of these progesterones, and then, okay, we will look for withdrawal bleeding. Okay, normally if estrogen, if the person has estrogen primed endometrium, then this progesterone will act on the estrogen primed endometrium, and this will lead to withdrawal bleeding. Okay, after 2 to 10 days, you'll see withdrawal bleeding. Sorry, after completion of the dose, it can be after 7 to 10 days. After completion of the dose, you can see withdrawal bleeding for 2 to 10 days. Okay, if this is seen, then it can be due to PCOS. Polycystic ovarian disease. This purely shows that estrogen is priming the endometrium. So there is no problem in the endometrium or in the estrogen. Mainly there is no problem in the estrogen. Okay. So it can indicate PCOS or late onset congenital adrenal hyperplasia or obesity. All these are seen if there is no bleeding. No bleeding. Okay. If there is no bleeding, then you'll have to give estrogen first, and then you'll also have to give progesterone. What estrogen will you give in this state? You give ethinyl estradiol 10 micrograms daily, or you can give conjugated equine estrogen. Conjugated equine estrogen can be given 1.2 milligrams daily. Okay, any of these, you can give ethinyl estradiol or conjugated equine estrogen, 1.2 milligrams daily can be given. And then you will also give progesterone. Okay, now first you give, before giving progesterone, you give estrogen for 2 weeks. Okay, when you give estrogen for 2 weeks, this causes priming of the endometrium. The endometrium gets primed with estrogen. Okay, now in the 3rd week, you will add progesterone, any of this progesterone mentioned above. So progesterone is added in 3rd week. Okay, now you have to see whether there is withdrawal bleeding or whether there is withdrawal bleeding or not. If there is withdrawal bleeding, then the problem is in estrogen. So you'll have to do prolactin, should be checked. If prolactin is high, then obviously it is hyperprolactinemia. Okay, then you'll have to see about TSH. If TSH is low, then it can be hypothyroidism. Okay, these are the other causes. But the main cause, it can be, you'll have to look for FSH or LH. Okay, this can be high or this can be low. If estrogen is low and FSH is low, then there is some hypothalamic or pituitary problems. Right, hypothalamic or pituitary problems. Okay, and if FSH is high and estrogen is low, then hypothalamus and pituitary is normal. Problem is in the ovary, right? So what type of ovary? It can be premature ovarian failure or resistant ovary. Okay, now if there is no bleeding, then if there is no bleeding even now the problem is in endometrium. Even we are giving estrogen, there is no priming of the endometrium. So now the problem is in the endometrium. So it can be due to tuberculosis or Asherman syndrome, where the problem is in uterus. Okay, so this is about the evaluation of secondary amenorrhea. Okay, how are you going to treat secondary amenorrhea? It's simple, treat the cause. The main treatment is you'll have to find the cause, and based on the cause, you'll have to treat the cause. I think you guys have understood something about the amenorrhea. So thank you guys for watching my lecture. If you have any doubts, please comment it in the comment section. Thank you for watching my lecture. Thank you.